If you didn't have that chance at Thanksgiving, I want you to do it now. Tell me, out loud, what are you grateful for?
My wife.
Your wife.
Family.
Family. Your health.
Jesus, new grandbaby.
Jesus, new grandbaby.
My church.
Your church.
Our jobs.
Our jobs. This is just life for us, and we take it sometimes for granted, and we really, it's really easy to take it for granted. And so we have to work at remembering life is gift. All that we have is gift from God. And we're called to be good stewards of it, and I'll talk a bit more about stewardship later on. But what are some of the things, we're motivated to do because we are grateful? So let's take a moment. What are you motivated to do because you're grateful? Speak up.
Serve others.
Serve others.
Share the joy.
Share the joy.
To give back.
To give back.
Serve the church.
Serve the church. These are all things as we really are conscious about gratitude. And we really care about realizing that God is the great giver and that we should show our gratitude and we should feel it deep in our heart and our spirit, that we should be motivated to give back in different ways. I wanted to show you this picture because we're in this season right now of Advent. We're in the third Sunday of Advent, in the great anticipation of the birth of Christ and the celebration of Jesus, who God sent to earth and God made manifest. Oh my goodness, that Jesus was born and we had the opportunity to see God embodied in human form. Amazing. What we learn from this. And I'm grateful for Mary. Now, this is a painting done by Henry Asawa Tanner. He was an African-American artist, very gifted artist, studied in Paris. And a lot of his works are biblical themes. And this one he did of the Annunciation. And when I first saw it, I was so struck because I thought, doesn't she look like a girl who might be 14 or 13 or even 12? And don't you imagine that the angel Gabriel might have appeared as a brilliant light just like this? And I was so moved by this. There's a real underlying theme in this picture. And it is her vulnerability and her willingness. She gave generously of her life to say, Lord, I will be your faithful servant. I will take on the calling you have given me in my life, and I will do that faithfully. Even though I know that it may mean hardship for Joseph, even though I know people may not understand, and I don't understand how in the world I could bear the Son of God, but I'm going to be faithful, and I'm going to give of my life in a generous way. And so I think there's a real theme here of generosity. And so I love this painting. I just wanted to share that with you. So the root from the word gratitude is gratis, and it means free, something spontaneously given. Now we think of gratuity. We think of what it means when we think about gratuity. And what is a gratuity, usually?
Yeah.
Tip. It's a tip. It's something that we may not generously give. And it may be born out of a motivation of expectation, not out of gratitude. So we're in this habit of this is expected, I will give it. So I wanted us to recall that the root of gratitude should really be something that is free and spontaneously given. But the reality is that gratitude gratitude sometimes has become something that's not born out of the motivation of Thanksgiving. You know? So I wanted to share with you the root of the word gratitude. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, in ordinary life, we hardly realize that we receive a great deal more than we give, and that it is only with gratitude that life becomes rich. It is only with gratitude that life becomes rich. So gratitude becomes an act. It becomes something very intentional. It becomes something that we say, we will work on this. I will work to be grateful. I will incorporate that in my life. When I get up every day and I see that sun come up, the discipline of thanking God when I wake up for this new day of life becomes a habit, and then it becomes something of great joy. And it helps form me and shape me. So when we really work on our spirit of gratitude, coming from a motivation of thanksgiving to God, the source of all that we have, it changes us. It changes our spirit. It changes how we see the world. We take a lot for granted in the United States because we have more than we need. We even have more than we often want. And it's very hard to relate to people in the world who don't have a roof over their head, who don't have food to eat, who don't have any source of income. That is a world that is so removed from us. That it's important work of the church, that the church be in the world. And I know you guys do a thing in South Dallas called Jubilee. It's big. I know that St. Michael's and All Angels does a lot of overseas mission. You go to Honduras, you've been to Bolivia, I'm sure you've been a number of places. We need to do those things because in our participating in Jubilee, in our participating in overseas mission, and even physically, if we can go do that, it changes us. We go with the motivation to help others and to experience something that is foreign to us. But what really happens is, usually, you come back much richer for that experience because your eyes are opened to being grateful. In 1981, my husband had an invitation to speak in Hong Kong. He was a PhD scientist. He is a PhD scientist. And he was invited to this international symposium. And this was 1981, when China was still closed. The Cultural Revolution had just ended 5 years before, and people really were not allowed to go to China, mainland China, unless they were invited. Well, they invited this group of scientists, including my husband, and I told them, you better believe I want to go. And we went to China, and my eyes were open. Imagine looking at a department store window, and for sale in that department store window were cast irons. Not electrical irons, cast irons. The poverty was so pervasive that it overwhelmed me. And I remember a visit we had with a woman in her apartment. Of course, they set up visits for us and wanted us to see and hear certain things. But we went to visit this woman in her apartment, and she shared a kitchen with 13 other families on the same floor. She had no heat in her apartment, but she had a little wood-burning stove in the middle. But her bedroom was off to the side. This was like a studio apartment, but her bedroom was a separate room. And we had an interpreter there, and it was freezing cold. We went to China the first week of December, and it was freezing in China. And we noticed how cold it was in the apartment and how cold it was in her bedroom, because we went into her bedroom. She sat on the edge of her bed. And one of the questions we asked with the interpreter was, how do you stay warm in the wintertime? Now, we all had our coats on. you know, cold in her arm. She reached under her bed and she pulled out a hot water bottle and she put it on her chest and she smiled broadly and she said, "This is how I stay warm." I want you to know I came back to America ashamed. Ashamed of all the things I had taken for granted in my life. It changed me to experience this encounter with this remarkable woman and to see this country. Many, many things have changed in China in the last 30 years, but I'm glad I went because that was a moment in time that really shaped my gratitude, and realizing that has made my life much richer. And Christmas morning birthdays, I don't know about you, but my mother, she would hand me a little stack of thank you notes and say, "Go to your room, don't come out until you've written every thank you note, and that's Christmas tree. Aunt Mary sent me this, and Grandma sent me this," and I had to have all those thank you notes written. Well, our mothers were just trying to instill in us the practice of gratitude. And I was very reluctant to do it. I didn't want to do it. I felt it was drudgery. But this is intentional. We have to learn often. We have to teach our children. We have to remind ourselves, what does it mean to say thank you? And what it really says to a person when you give thanks. The same as our relationship with God. Every day we should have as part of our prayers, thank you. Thank you for this, and thank you for this, and thank you for that. And whatever it is, should be a key portion of your daily prayer life. Because as you say those prayers of thanksgiving, it shapes you, it changes you, it opens your eyes to God and the world and God's generosity to us. I've often said, do we have the eyes to see, the heart to feel, and the mind to know that God is ever present with us? Do we have the eyes to see, the heart to feel, the mind to know that God, through the Holy Spirit, is always with us? There's so many things that happen in our lives that we don't even know how God has intervened, how God has acted, how God has poured out His Spirit. Sometimes I hope, like you, I hope all of you have had at some point in your life a time when you really felt God in your deepest soul and you knew God's presence. Maybe it was a time of great grief. Maybe it was a time of great joy, but that you knew God's presence. I cannot imagine life without God in it. But we have to constantly remind ourselves we need to be grateful for those things. When we say thank you, it reminds us that we have never achieved anything on our own. We are truly interdependent. There is a reason why Jesus said before he went to the cross, said, "Gather together, break bread together, remember me, remember me." And we as Episcopalians have the privilege of the liturgy of Holy Communion being central to our worship, so that we never forget God's great gift. And when we think about that, Jesus gave the ultimate gift of generosity. He gave up everything. Took on our sins. He gave up everything for us. Tremendous generosity. And when it really comes to thinking about what is the difference between gratitude and generosity, let's think about what it means to be generous. Generous is really giving. Giving of yourself beyond just a tip. Beyond just being thankful. God makes me interdependent. God created us to be in community. So how do you show gratitude for the community of St. Michael's and All Angels? Now, I'm going to ask you guys to talk to each other just for a minute. And I want you to think of two or three ways that St. Michael's and All Angels has shaped and influenced your life. How has this church shaped and influenced your life? So just turn around to someone, if you're sitting by yourself, or a person sitting next to you, and let's just share for a few minutes that, and I want to hear some of those things after you finish talking.
Yes.
Well, the most recent memory is having the opportunity
And that's the way the church should be.
Yes.
I was asked a question recently about giving to the church as opposed to giving to really meaningful and significant nonprofits. And we're all in a position, probably in this room, where we do both. We have some of our favorite charities, and we love St. Michael's, and we give. But what really differentiates the two when it comes to our giving decisions? First, I would say that God is in the world working in all kinds of ways, through all sorts of associations and groups, and doing remarkable work in the world. I think of Doctors Without Borders, for one. Oh my goodness. Sacrifice and giving and tremendous work that they do. And there's so many groups that are worthy of our support. There are no groups in the world that have the mission to shape you as an individual, as a Christian, and to help you grow in your relationship with God, and to offer you the opportunity to worship in a beautiful way, and to be provided with opportunities that otherwise you may never experience, so that you too can go out and be involved and grow deeper and richer in your own gratitude. We take the church away, it's a huge hole. God created the church for a reason. We have that fundamental mission, and it's extremely important to support it. And honestly, many of the groups around the world that do incredible work were born out of people's faith in God, and that's why they give back. And it has become a nonprofit, or it's become a whatever it is in their effort. So we are a breeding ground. In the garden, we are the place that cultivates relationship with God. Understanding what it means to be in community when we do things we do well, when we fail, and maybe not do so well, and pick each other up and support each other, and then go out. Come together and worship and go out. So I'm here to say that I believe that the support of the church, both with your time, with your talent, and particularly your resources of money, are fundamentally important to go to the church first. So a lot of conversation about tithe in Scripture. It's a starting place. It's never an end. That sounds like and I do a lot of work with churches, and people usually wince when I begin to talk about tithe as being the starting place. But the reality is, we're all on a journey. We are on a journey of spiritual growth. We're on a journey of gratitude. We're on a journey to grow into generosity. And we have to examine, where are we in that journey? If I could draw a line and say, I kind of know it started here at this event in my life, and I began to understand about giving back. Where are you on that spectrum of from here to generous beyond the fall? We're all on that spectrum somewhere. I just encourage you to recognize that, because what we tend to do in the church is we love the church, we love the community of people. It is home for many of us in terms of friends and activities and worship. But many people, it's just another check. It's just another thing I support that's a good thing to support. I think it's so much deeper than that. And we need to come to that conversation with God about, am I giving of who I am and my talent and my resources back Baptist St. Michael's, to glorify you, because ultimately that is why St. Michael's and all angels exist. Where am I in that journey? It's really important. I have taped to my monitor on my computer. Yes, sir. Question.
I just want to kind of support your program, but the church is us.
The church is us.
So basically, we're giving to ourselves to continue the progress that we're getting. And I think we miss that in stewardship. We don't say we're giving to ourselves to be able to do these things, and we leave it as another ministry to get to, and that doesn't work very well.
That's a really good point. It is about supporting the community of people, because the church is always the people. That this beautiful facility burned down tomorrow, St. Michael's and all angels would not go away, because it's the people. Wherever the church is gathered, they're gathering in all kinds of places. In Texas, we have some unusual places that people are gathering. Everything from gymnasiums to Starbucks to Taco Bells to food trucks. We're just gathering people all over the place, and that's the church. And I'm sure you're doing some of that in Dallas, too. So we lose sight of that because we get caught up in our facilities. But you know what? The facilities are the support system for the ministry. You know, they support. That's their function. They support worship. They support the ministry. So these things go hand in hand. The fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. I will tell you that I have to remind myself constantly about the fruit of the Spirit. I work at a lot of churches, and sometimes they're in crisis, and I get all kinds of phone calls, and I just have to take a deep breath and remind myself that when God manifests in through us as the Holy Spirit, this is what comes out, these kind of behaviors. But you know, so often, if we just resort to our human nature, we do just the opposite. Instead of these things: hatred, sorrow, violence, impatience, rudeness, cruelty, lack of faith, harshness, and loss of control are often our human nature. Thank you. So we need to really remind ourselves that this is a gift, and God is guiding us in this. So I want to talk a bit about what is stewardship. And I love this definition. It's from Funk and Wagner's Dictionary. It says, one who is entrusted with the management of property, finances, or other affairs not his own. We love to gather stuff. We know to buy stuff, keep stuff, hoard stuff. I mean, we just take it all in. And it's not ours. It's not ours. What happens to all that when we die? It's not ours. It ends up going somewhere else, or someone buying it, or a trash heap. We are called by God to be stewards of all that we have been given in through our giftedness, through our talents, abilities, through our financial resources, and to know that these things are not our own, and this helps us release them. It helps us to get a perspective on all that we have and to give it back, just to release it, because it's not ours in the first place. God is the great giver. And when we keep that in our hearts and our minds, we begin to really understand life. Life gets richer. We are more fulfilled. I want to show you, bear with me for just a second. I want to show you a little video. Excuse me. It's a video on giving, and we're gonna hope that it comes up and the sound comes up. Thank you. some of the memorial statements. Giving is an expression of who possesses you. I love that. The more you give, the more you have. We make a great life by what we give. It is impossible to love without giving. I would add, it is impossible to love God without giving. But there is one thing at the very last slide that said, they may forget what you said and they forget what you did, but they will never forget how you made them feel. If our motivation for giving is in how it makes another person feel, we miss the point. Because it is in giving that we are changed. We are changed. It really doesn't matter how they feel. The motivation is that God will change us because we give. And the more generous we are, God seems to just pour it out. One of the stories from Scripture that we don't often hear when we talk about and stewardship campaigns and annual giving campaigns, it's the story of the Good Samaritan. But really, this is a stewardship story. This poor guy was injured, probably beat up and robbed, and many people passed right by him and ignored his need. But this Samaritan stopped and gave of himself his time, his efforts, his finances, in order to support this person in need. And I doubt for a moment that he was concerned about how this guy felt. He was probably motivated out of a love for God and love for his fellow man and wanting to give of himself in ways that were extraordinary. The Good Samaritan was generous. He gave his time, he gave his ability, he gave of his financial wherewithal, and he asked for nothing in return. So we just have 5 minutes left. I have one story I want to tell you, but I want to emphasize a bit about generosity. Scott Bader Saying is on the faculty at the Seminary of the Southwest, and he has written a book called Following Jesus in a Culture of Fear. It's a fantastic book. It makes a great study, by the way. And this is what he says. Generosity happens when we release control and allow God to use us as a conduit for his blessing. I mean, if we claim that we understand that the Holy Spirit dwells among us and in us, when we open ourselves to be generous and really letting God work through us, generosity. I haven't stopped learning. These are pictures of my daughter-in-law and my son, who have been missionaries in Honduras. They've recently came home because they had their first child. And so they're in Houston right now. But Terry is an electrical engineer. You see from her caption, she's an Auburn graduate. And she has installed solar in orphanages, clinics, compounds, mission compounds, 13 times in Haiti. Mexico, Nicaragua, Honduras, mountain schools with no electricity. She designs the systems. She supervises the installations, and she does the installations, and she's never been made of any to do it. And her motivation is because she loves God. And she wants to give back of her ability to help those in need. I learned by watching my daughter-in-law. My son's son, this is a picture of him. He was teaching in a Christian school in Honduras, and he had all these little students, and he had to learn Spanish, and it's a church school, and he just gave up himself. And when they left Houston to live in Honduras, they sold everything they had, everything, and said, Mom, we're fine. We don't need much. We'll figure out. They had a bed, a couch. They finally rented a little house. But just watching them give their lives away, I haven't stopped learning, but I want to finish with a story about an encounter I had with a beggar. It taught me more about stewardship than I've ever learned from anywhere else. It was 1998. I was a deputy to General Convention in Philadelphia, and it was Saturday afternoon. We were 5 days to the General Convention, which was very contentious. It was not pleasant. And we had a break. So I walked down to Independence Hall by myself. I said, I gotta get out of here. 5,000 Episcopalians here, gotta get out. And I went down after 5 days to my level, but I had to have some time by myself. And so I went down to Independence Hall, loved it, it was great. And I'm walking back in historic Philadelphia, and those sidewalks are really wide there, like it's old, you know. And there was a beggar who was crippled. He was so crippled, he was sitting on his broken legs that were spread eagle under him. He had a crutch beside him leaning on the wall. Now, I will tell you, one of my spiritual gifts is not mercy. And I don't say that with pride. And I thought, one more beggar. And I'm just going to walk over here close to the curb, because he's 12 feet away from me, and he won't, bother me. So I'm walking right by him without looking at it, and he yells out, "Sister, stop and talk to me." This is what I did. I looked up, and I went, "God, I know you're watching me. I know I'm here at General Convention, and I better go stop. Talk to him." So I'm very tall. He was very short because he was on his torso. And I leaned down so that I could look at him in the face. I had a cross on. And he grabbed my cross and he pulled it down and said, "Are you a Christian?" And scared the creeps out of me. And I went, "Yes." And then I thought, this guy's so bold, I'm going to ask him if he's a Christian. So I said, "Are you a Christian?" He said, "Oh, yes. And let me tell you everything God has ever done for me." He pulled up a tattered t-shirt he had on with scars all over his chest, and he said, "I was stabbed by a gang, and God saved my life." Then he pushed up his sleeve, and have you ever seen a bone that has not been set, but the skin has grown over it? He said, "I have broken many bones in my life, but God has always healed me." Then he said, "I've never been without a bed, and I've never been without a meal." So then he said, "Mary, will you come back and visit me tomorrow?" And I said, first of all, he asked me my name. He said, "What's your name?" And I said, "Mary." I said, "What's your name?" And he said, "Roscoe." And then he said, "Mary, will you come back and visit me tomorrow? I'll be right here." I said, "Roscoe, I have to be at this big meeting down the street. I'm not going to be able to come back." And he said, "Well, then, will you pray for me?" And I said, "I will pray for you." And I said, "Roscoe, will you pray for me, especially this next week while I'm in Philadelphia?" And he said, "Yes." By this time, I was so choked up, just ready to cry. I pulled out a couple of bills, and I put them in a styrofoam cup. We said our goodbyes, and I started walking away. And he yelled out in a very clear, loud voice, "Mary, I love you." I want to tell you that I felt like I was Paul on the road to Damascus, and I had just encountered Jesus. It was so profound that I burst into tears. I put my sunglasses on. I walked to the hotel, and a good friend was coming out the revolving door, and she said, "What is wrong with you?" And I said, "I just encountered Jesus on the street." I knew it. I knew he was a messenger from God. I knew it. So I went up to my room, and I shut the door. I didn't go out to dinner with anyone. And I said, "What did he say to me? If he was a messenger from God, what did he say?" First of all, I challenged my belief. "Are you a Christian?" And then he asked my name. And then he proceeded to show me his wounds. And my husband had been through a near fatal accident. He was 32 years old. And I almost lost him. And for the grace of God, I didn't. And all I could think of was, God has been so good to me. I've never been without a bed. I've never been without a meal. And have I really been grateful? And then ultimately, he said, "Will you pray? Will you come with me tomorrow? Will you come here tomorrow? Will you pray every single day and be in conversation with me?" That's what I asked of you, Mary, because I've given you so. steward, which I really had not been in the past, after that encounter, realizing all that God had entrusted to me, that was not my own. And how was I going to be generous in return? So I want to leave you with this question. It's time to go to church, but I want you to reflect on this. How will you respond to God's generosity in your life at this time, as St. Michael's and All Angels goes through its annual giving campaign? How will you financially support this community and its ministry for 2016? And in all things and in all ways, be grateful.